Ladies and gentlemen, welcome. The first row is free. So if everybody who's sitting in the back can come forward and sit here. I see one person stepping up. So again, bit by bit, we're coming there. Yeah. No? Afraid? Yeah. Please, at the last row, can you come sit here? It looks, for the one that's giving the presentation, it looks a little bit better, more cozy. Yeah, great. Thank you. Welcome, everybody. I hope the first breakout session went well. You ran to this room here. We're here for a really short breakout session, so I think questions, keep them to yourself, and later on ask them to the two speakers we have here. We're going to have a short masterclass with the two speakers about smart mobility, shared mobility. I can talk a lot here. I won't do it. I will give the words to Angelo from Belgium, from Ghent. He's working for a taxi stop. Come up. Give an applause to Angelo.
I'm not sure if Jan Straub is still here in this room. Yep. I really loved in your presentation that you recognized as a city that you still have many questions about car sharing. Many other cities, they pretend that they have the answers already, but there's still so much to learn about car sharing. I don't have the answers neither, but asking the right questions is I think, the right strategy to go into the right evolution. So I really loved it. I'm going to give a mini masterclass. So I won't have much time, but that after this mini masterclass, you can put on your CV that you are a mini master in smart and shared mobility. So that's my objective of this presentation. I'm working for an NGO called TaxiStop in Belgium. TaxiStop is an NGO already operator in shared mobility since 1975. Belgium, a country we are really good in making beers, but really bad in spatial planning. We have the worst urban sprawl, I think, in Europe or maybe all over the world. So there are many challenges. As the other presenters, we don't own land. So we cannot do something with land, but we own a lot. What we do is making better use of existing resources, idling capacity, empty seats in cars, but also cars standing in the street. So we offer car sharing also. We have an on-demand transport service for elderly people. We innovate and we work on awareness. That's what we are doing as TaxiStop in Belgium and sometimes in Europe. Smart mobility. There are so many definitions of smart mobility. I won't try it. But many people agree that the future trends for transport are electric transport, connected, autonomous, and shared transport. You've heard already a lot of it today. I will give a small intro to that. Electric mobility, of course, you saw in another presentation for the people who were in the other session, that is not the biggest game changer. An electric car is consuming as much space as a conventional car. But of course, it has a positive impact. Very often, there are a lot of subsidies, in Flanders, many subsidies for electric cars. But if you give the same amount of subsidies to public transport, the impact is much higher. And it's a pity that sometimes there's not enough awareness of that. Investing in electric buses, the impact is 100 times bigger. That's what I've learned from people from Bremen. Of course, the electric bikes, they have an impact also, but I'm not here to teach you something about bikes. In the Netherlands, you know much better how to deal with bikes. We are good in cycling, in the sports, but not so good in the planning of it. Connected mobility is another trend. Connected mobility, and I think that's also for people working in housing development, you know a lot about City of Things, the software also around the houses. But if you can make transport and cars, vehicles, and every type communicate with houses, with streets, there are a lot of opportunities. With the data, you can do a lot. Still, we don't know yet what is every possible solution with it, but at least the data and the connectivity can steer us into the right direction. Connectivity means also the mobility as a service platforms, for instance. Mobility as a service.
Angelo, your mic, can you?
Is it?
Yeah.
Okay, sorry. Yep. Mobility as a service platform is like an app where you can use that you can use to buy several tickets for public transport, for bike sharing. You have access with one app to several transport modes. And that's really hot in the world of transport today. There are many discussions going on about mobility as a service. Also, like from what I've learned from the Netherlands, is that every bike sharing operator should be connectable with those apps. I think that's a really strong strategy, and probably the Netherlands is the first region with this strategy for bike sharing. That's a really good solution. But of course, you can connect everything via an app, but if there are no transport solutions or sustainable transport solutions nearby, your smartphone won't solve this, the problems. And that's why the mobility hubs are important. You saw it also in Utrecht, they are planning mobility hubs. In Amsterdam, they are planning mobility hubs. We call it in Dutch, in Flanders, Mobipunten. Also, a partner in the project, Advir, is also calling it Mobipunten. It's important to give it a name. That's what we've learned from the Bremen. They call it Mobilpunkt. And to give it a clear name, it's a short German word, Mobilpunkt, yes. But a clear name is very good for a new concept. A clear name, and every city using the same name, that's important, because you are learning something new to the people. Then don't invent in every city a new word. And in Flanders, at least, we're promoting the word Mobipunten. And since recently, it's part of the new Flemish transport regulation. So it's an official word, Mobipunt. And we are on track. That's our ambition as Taxistop from my organization, and we want to force the Flemish government to go into that direction also, to have 1,000 Mobi hubs in 2025. And a Mobi hub is a solution to switch from one mode to another mode, but also a solution to have access to different transport modes in every neighborhood. The other trend is autonomous mobility. Autonomous mobility. Still, no one knows when we will have autonomous cars really in cities with a lot of bicycles. There are cities, Caroline from UITP is here also, she will give a presentation later, but she told me she was in Singapore two weeks ago, and there they are planning already a neighborhood with only autonomous cars. But the bigger game changer also there, in the same neighborhood, they will plan neighborhoods without car ownership. So that has more impact also. For us, the biggest game changer is going from ownership to shared mobility. Autonomous mobility is not only about cars, it's about public transport, big events also, and maybe we will see them first in the cities. There are already in some European cities those autonomous buses on certain tracks and certain neighborhoods. It has also, autonomous cars can also solve problems not only in cities, but also in rural areas where public transport organizing it is really expensive, but without paying drivers, it could be more efficient. It can be a solution also in city centers. So, but when they are really coming and having an impact in our cities in Europe, it's not so clear. If you listen to the market, they will come rather soon. If you listen to scientists, we will have to wait until 2030, 2040. We don't know it yet. So we saw already in the presentation from this morning from Uber, from Julien, I think, that okay, Uber is thinking about 2030 maybe to get rid of all its drivers. Maybe it will be sooner, maybe later, it's not so clear. There are still a lot of questions about future autonomous cars, about economic impact for elderly people, for instance, impact about inclusion, and together with the city of Bremen, we are planning to think a lot and to share this, to ask the right questions about a future with autonomous cars. Today, there's a lot of research about the technology, but for governments, we should do much more research about the impact on spatial planning, for instance, impact on inclusion and so on. So that's very important to know, to have answers on that before the cars are coming into our streets. And then we go into shared mobility. Shared mobility, there are many services in shared mobility. You have the ride sourcing or ride hailing apps, the Uber systems or Lyft. It's new taxi services. From my own experience, it has not so much impact on cities. Taxi service has a big impact. But I had an experience a couple of weeks ago. I was in the United States, and there I've used Uberpool, and that was impressive. If you ever go to the United States or to a city, maybe there are, Uberpool exists already in the UK also, I'm not sure about that. How fast it works, how efficient it works, it really has a big impact, and it's a special experience also. You have the carpool apps also. Have someone of you already used BlaBlaCar, for instance? Yep. Yes, some of you. BlaBlaCar is a very reliable, good solution to go from one city to another country. There are also carpool programs with more focus on commuters, on short distances. So that has we are taxi stop. We have an app for the short distance for commuters because we think that has more impact. Because you have impact on the daily travel behavior. You also, the bike sharing, which is booming also. And first we had the OV fiets in the Netherlands, for instance. It's really good solution for the last mile, or not only for the last mile, but if you take a train from one city to another city, and then you can use it. We have Blue Bike in Belgium. It was inspired by OV fiets in the Netherlands. But the last years, there were more urban programs. The Chinese people were coming with the dockless bikes. And then they're already in many, they left already in many cities. But you see many startups also in Amsterdam, Urbi, for instance, CarGuru. So there are many local startups right now also in bike sharing. And I think that bike parking became an issue also in Flanders, in the Netherlands. So there's a lot of, there are many opportunities also for bike sharing. I also saw a very good study from a Dutch operator who offers dockless bike sharing, so the technology is on the bike. And they've learned if you put the bikes on hubs, even without a locking system at the hub, but a locking system on the bike, that more people are using the bikes. So if bike sharing is organized in hubs, more people are using the bikes. That was interesting for us to learn that, hubs are relevant also for dockless systems. New since 1-2 years, the scooters, you see them everywhere, only not in Amsterdam, so in every big city. Really good for last mile solutions in the cities, but a competitor to walking. Walking is very important for health, public health also. So there are some issues also with it. There are some issues because it's seen as it's not, there are too many on the pavement, especially where pavement is not large enough. So there are some issues, but it's very nice, reliable solution for short distances inside the city. That is the icon produced in the Netherlands via the Green Deal, used in Bremen also. We are promoting it also in Belgium for car sharing. And there are different types of car sharing also. You have car sharing where operators are offering a fleet with fixed hubs, with car sharing stations, like Greenwheels, for instance. I think Greenwheels is still working with stations in the Netherlands. But you have also the free floating. You can pick up a car at one point and drop the car at another point. The mobility behavior is different if you use one system or another system. With the station, it's more used for longer distances, for shopping, for instance. For free floating, it's more used. Once I saw a study from Car2Go in the Netherlands, it was like the Car2Go in Amsterdam was a little bit for the bike when it was raining. So I saw, it's really short conclusion, but it was a little bit like that. You also have the platforms for peer-to-peer car sharing. Snapcar is one of the most successful startups in that, coming from the Netherlands, and you have also more community-based systems like MyWheels in the Netherlands also. So there are many different types of operators with different impacts, and if you plan with car sharing, it's very important to be aware with bike sharing or car sharing, what kind of operator are inviting in your planning. We are involved in a station-based car sharing company in Belgium. We are, together with the public transport operators, we are shareholder of it, and we see the impact on travel behaviors. We really see a modal shift that more people are using sustainable modes since they became member of a car sharing company. There's less car usage because of it. That's a study we have done. It's not only we have done that study, you see that kind of results in other studies, also in Bremen, but also in Switzerland and elsewhere, you see the same conclusions. So it's something else, if we're going to shared mobility, if we look into the future, And there are two ways to look to the future. There's research, like this research from PricewaterhouseCoopers, but there's also, you can look to the United States, what's happening already today. And from PricewaterhouseCoopers, we know that we are going from 280 million cars in Europe to 200 million cars. So that's really positive, what we think. But there will be more car usage. And that's not what we really want to have, because the streets are not big enough. And now I have to hurry, my time is over right now.
3 seconds.
Okay, so we see what is happening right now is that also the new shared mobility services are creating more car usage because there's some reflective car usage of those new services like Uber or maybe free floating services. As a city planner should be aware of that and see what you can do with it. One of the solutions for that is the planning, like I saw in Amsterdam, and one of the examples I saw before is to bring the public transport, the sustainable modes closer by, and other modes which are creating more car usage further away from where people are living. That's one of the solutions to make a reflex for use of sustainable transport modes, and also in housing planning. You can do that. There's an example in France, it's called Garage Swap. And instead of investing money in garages, they're investing the money in solar energy production, but also in car sharing, for instance. That's how they are planning it. And they bring the cars further away and they make from car usage more reflex because people who are buying a house, they're not owning a car anymore. The question I often get is, are new mobility services asking for hubs? Yes, they are. Even Uber wants to work with hubs. If you use Uber Pool, they ask you to walk to a place, and the car is not coming to you. They're asking to walk to a hub that's more efficient to combine journeys. So Uber is asking for it, but also new free-floating services, car sharing operators are asking for it. And you never know with new innovative systems for mobility. So for planners, create space for sustainable and shared mobility. I think it's really crucial for a structural solution for the future. Thank you.
You made it. Thank you, Angelo Meuleman. Thank you for this great overview. I'm afraid we haven't got time left for questions, but well, people can come to you. You stay. Okay, that's great. Thank you. For the second masterclass, we go back to Amsterdam to Lisanne John. She's working for the Chief Technology Office from the Municipality of Amsterdam on the Smart Mobility Program, and she's going to tell you more about it. Lisanne.
Thank you. I work for the City of Amsterdam as Program Manager of Smart Mobility, and at this moment we're working on our new program, Smart Mobility, and I will tell you a little bit more about that. Can I have a clicker?
Of course.
Yes. Thank you. So we're working on the Amsterdam approach to shape the future of mobility. I will tell you a little bit more about the trends, the city challenges, our ambitions, and how we look at the near future. If you look at this moment, what's happening in Amsterdam, you see the city is growing, it's more busier. Today it's very busy at this area, but you see also that the mobility is increasing. If the city keeps growing as it does now, the city will become full and there will be no more place for the cars. And there were jokes in this morning that there are some kind of traffic jams on the bike lanes. Well, it feels like a joke, but for a lot of people it's becoming a problem because it's also a safety problem, and also with the how you feel about safety and the journey that you have to travel in Amsterdam. And you see also we have a challenge with the environment. We would like to have a clean city, we like to have clean air, and that not, if you look at other cities, that people have to walk with mondkapjes. Sorry. It's important to have clean air, but you see also at this moment a lot of bridges and canes are closed because they are collapsing. You see the city is old. In 2025 the city will be 750 years, but you see as city we have to keep our city healthy. And you see also at this moment a lot of platforms are entering Amsterdam, but also other cities, because they see a chance. They see people are willing to use the platforms like Uber, Via Ven. But it's also a question about who's responsible for the data and how are you manage a city, the mobility management. And you see also there are different kinds of transports, and Angelo mentioned at this moment the e-scooters, in Dutch we call them the steps, are not allowed because they are very seems that they are dangerous. Yesterday there was an article when you hit a step with 50 kilometers per hour, 95% of the people will die. So it's also interesting, how are we as a city going to deal with this new kinds of micromobility? Also keeping in mind with what the users are willing, because they are, you see a lot of people are wanting to use this new kind of micromobility. Well, if you see the challenges for us as a city, we say we would like to be a clean city. We have a zero ambition. We want to be a zero ambition in 2025. Electric cars are very important. You see the speed of technology with all the new kind of platforms. What kind of role are we going to play as a city? And how are we going to deal with this public space? How are we going to do the urban planning? Are we going to develop some hubs? Are we going to build high buildings? Or are we going to expand to other cities? So how can we design the mobility city of the future for our city that we love and would like to live in and become old in? And if you see at this moment, if we don't do anything, what will happen in the city? You see that the city won't be accessible for everybody. For us, it's very important that the city is accessible for everybody, that we have clean air, that we know what's happening in the city, that it's not too full, that the streets are not closed because it's too busy with pedestrians. So you see, we won't do anything, the city will look like this, full with cars, too many people, and the city has no control of what's happening in our region. And you see at this moment, digitalization is very important. You see, for example, sorry, it's in Dutch, but I will translate it. You see at this moment, Google Maps or Apple, almost everybody looks at their phone when they have to navigate somewhere. You see, tourists do this also. And in this article, it describes that some tourists, they drive with their bicycle into the Piet Hein Tunnel. And well, they said, well, my phone said I was allowed to go in the tunnel. And well, normally you think, well, if you just look, you know, it's not allowed for bicycles. But you see the mindset of a lot of people, they're only looking at their phones and just follow the maps that is navigating them. And for us at City, it was very strange that it was very difficult to come in contact with Apple to change this in their navigations. So that's also something for us to keep in mind. How are we going to deal with these kinds of navigations and with the data? And that's also the other example with the fitness app Strava. A lot of soldiers used it, and because of the data, it was showed where their location is. The soldiers didn't thought about it. They thought, yeah, we're just using it because we have to keep fit and healthy. But you see what data can do with it. And another example is in Uber, due to the data and also with the Uber pool, mobility becomes more cheaper than public transport. And it's a question, do we want that as city or not? It's a question and also a challenge, I think. So we say, what if a city, we have our responsibility, what kind of city would we like to be? We'd like to have a city that is that we are in control. We know what's happening with the crowd management. Everybody that operates in the public area should share their data with us. We should have some hubs. We should also use the water for the logistics, but also think about the future. If the drones are coming, then the building should also be ready for it. And you see the ambitions that we have as a city. We would like to be a shared city. Not only, it's not about especially about the numbers, but also about the mindset and the behavior of people, that sharing they say sharing is caring, but it's also keep in mind, do you really need your private car if you live in a city? Especially people that live in a city center, the people that have that own a car, it's only used once a week. So that's also a question, do you really need your car, or can you also use shared carring or use public transport or just go by bike or walk? Another ambition is that we have manage our digital mobility system. So that means a city, we would like to monitor, analyze, but also steer with the data that we're going to collect and predict how are we going to make our city. And the third line is that all citizens and visitors travel cleaner and smarter through the city. And how are we going to do that? We're going to do that via an Amsterdam approach, the way we work. It's important that we do it together with our citizens, but also a lot with our partners that we have. At this moment, we have already a lot of partners with the universities, but also the corporate partners. And you see, it's also important to just also do some pilots, test it, and also scaling it up. And it's important to keep in mind that we're doing this for who we're doing this, not for ourselves, but for our citizens and the people that live here and work here. So we've got two plans. The data is important and innovation mobility solutions. And if you look at the data, we're really working at the mobility center of the future. For example, next year we've got the EK. It's important for us that we know how the visitors enter Amsterdam and how we're going to steer them and give them information of how can you enter the city. And this also really asks how are we going to work with mobility providers and other platforms that they share their data and we can analyze it. So these are two important events that we're going to work on with the crowd management. And if you look at the other line, the innovative mobility solutions, it's for us important to change the behavior of the users, but also create public space for new kind of mobility concepts. We would like to test with, for example, the steps, but keeping in mind that it's safe, but also the Biro is a big example people are using at this moment. And it's also our role to anticipate on what's happening. It's not, we can't say anymore that we didn't see it coming, because we know what's coming and we have to prepare on that. At this moment, we're also working with Mobility as a Service at the Zuidas that will be launched at the end of this year. You see also with the Amsterdam Arena, we're working a lot about innovations, and that's also an area that we say it should be more integrated with the people that live there and with the people that work there. And you see also the hubs. We have from the European Commission, we received some subsidy to work on hubs on street level. And you see, as a city, it's our role that people that live in Amsterdam, that they get the chance to make their own hub, and a city we facilitate on that. That's the smaller hubs, we call them. But you see also with the presentation before, there are some bigger hubs, and we're also thinking about that. So we're working on small hubs, medium hubs, and large hubs now and in the future. This was a forward, example of Strand Eiland, of Steven mentioned here before. And you see that's a new area, urban planning. So you see we have a responsibility for the existing city, but also for the new city. And if you look at the anticipation, we're working on self-driving boats with the canals that we really would like to use them, and making them smarter also with the sensoring that we know when it's full. For example, with King's Day this and with the Pride, the canals are very full, and if we use the sensors and more the data, then we can steer also the public in the water. And you see also with drones, are we thinking about what is the role of drones, for example, with the hospitals? We see them with chances, but you see example, I think New York Pizza is also interesting to work with drones. That's also a question of city, are we going to allow that, and how do we see that in the coming years? We're also looking at blockchain. Blockchain is also at this moment interesting, for example, with the logistics. And you see also bikes are very important for Amsterdam. So we keep innovating with bikes. For example, also making an app. It's very strange for people maybe, but a lot of people in Amsterdam lose their bike because they park it wrong. I think at this moment a lot of bikes are also parked wrong. Today they won't be removed, but in some areas your bike will be removed in one day. And then we will develop an app that we help you to find your bike back. So this is the presentation.
Thank you, Lisa. So it's been 2:30. I think you all need a drink after those breakout sessions. We continue at 3 o'clock, and the doors will be open. So thank you for being here. Dankjewel.